I'm happy to present part of our work on when and how self-cleaning of superhydrophobic surfaces work. Here you see lotus leaf, the most famous example of self-cleaning surfaces. A deposited or impacting water droplet easily rolls off, taking particles and other contaminants along. As another example you see here, a superhydrophobic surface is contaminated by chalk. And again, as water droplet rolls off the superhydrophobic surface, it takes along the chalk particles. To gain deeper insight into self-cleaning, first I like to discuss relevant aspects of wetting, including what determines how easily a droplet rolls over a surface. The fundamentals of wetting go back to Thomas Young. He realized that the angle a droplet forms with the surface depends on the difference of the interfacial tension between the solid and air and solid and liquid, divided by the interfacial tension between liquid air. However, this only holds in thermodynamic equilibrium and for ideally smooth and chemically homogeneous surfaces. In reality, that is rarely the case, actually never the case. So in reality, the contact angle always varies between the advancing angle and the receding contact angle. The advancing contact angle is the largest angle a droplet forms before the three-phase contact line likes to advance. And the receding angle is the smallest angle the droplet takes before it recedes. The three-phase contact line recedes. The difference between these two angles is termed contact angle hysteresis. And this is a very important quantity, and it depends on pinning. So how strongly is the droplet pinned on the surface? For real surfaces, we often also need to consider roughness. So real surfaces are rarely smooth. And here you see a droplet resting on a hydrophobic surface, and the droplet can completely wet the rough surface underneath, or the droplet can sit on the top faces of the asperities. Depending on which situation, whether we have full wetting, then we say just the droplet is in the Wenzel state. If the droplet rests on top of the asperities, then we say the droplet is in the Cassie state. As you can imagine, depending on here the interaction between the droplet and the substrate, the ease of motion greatly differs. And this ease of motion is a measure of the friction force. Therefore, we asked ourselves, can we measure the friction force? And here you see the setup we developed. Therefore, we placed a droplet on a substrate, on a superhydrophobic surface, in this case, a micropillar array. And we moved the surface underneath at a certain velocity. To keep the drop in position, we used the capillary, which holds the droplet while the surface underneath is moving at a certain velocity. And that is what you see here. Now we let the surface move and the droplet is deformed, but held by the capillary. You see that this force causes a bending of the capillary. Furthermore, because we moved the droplet over a micropillar array, you see these periodic variations, the position of the capillary. So how now to get the force from this deformation? Therefore, we can make use of Hooke's law. Hooke realized that the force to deform a capillary depends on the degree of deformation times the spring constant of the capillary. If we make use of Hooke's law and insert the spring constant of the capillary and the measured deflection, we obtain the force while the droplet moves over the surface. And on average, we have a force close to 13 micronewton. As mentioned beforehand, while the droplet is moving over micropillar arrays, therefore we have periodic pinning and depinning events, implying that we have variations in the force. So this maximum and minima provide a measure of the force needed to depin the droplet from a row of micropillars. And the distance between these maxima reflect the distance between two micropillar arrays, two rows of micropillar arrays, and depends therefore on the spacing and the geometry and the size of the micropillars. For this situation, we have a force in the order of 2.3 micronewton. I mentioned that this one is the friction force, but I'm sure about it. And how does this force relate to the lateral adhesion force? As I also mentioned that the contact angles are extremely important. Therefore, how do these two forces correlate? The friction force, or the Hooke's force, and the lateral adhesion force we obtain if we integrate along the three-phase contact line. And this integration yields that we have the interfacial tension times the horizontal component of the interfacial tension, yielding the difference between the receding and the advancing contact angle times the apparent contact width. The proportionality results that we have small variation on the shape of the three-phase contact line, and these small variations are reflected in detail-specific prefactor. What I also like to stress is that on a superhydrophobic surface, the advancing contact angle is always close to 180 degrees, and therefore the receding contact angle determines the stickiness of the surface, of the droplet on the surface. Now, how well do these two forces agree? And we were very pleased when we realized that we observed a very nice agreement. Here you see that just as soon as we start to deform the droplet, the force increases, it passes a threshold force, that is the force which needs to be overcome so that the three-phase contact line can deepen. Then we have the deformation of the shape of the droplet till we reach the steady state, so where the droplet now moves over the rough surface, over our micropillar array or other surface. So that makes also a huge difference, that contrast to solid friction, where we have a sharp transition from the threshold to the kinetic regime. Here for droplets, we have a smooth transition because droplets can reorganize. So that what we learned is that we can measure the friction force of droplets moving over superhydrophobic or other types of surfaces, hydrophobic surfaces. So from that, I like to move on to friction of the droplet experience if it takes contaminants along. And therefore, we contaminated different types of surfaces with particles, hydrophilic and hydrophobic particles having different size, so varying between roughly 80 nanometer up to 550 micrometer, and the particles were either hydrophilic and or hydrophobic and fluorescently labeled because we wanted to investigate everything using laser scanning confocal microscopy. Here you see three photos taken by laser scanning confocal microscopy. The first one shows the droplet just in front of the particle, the front side of the droplet. Here you see a few particles on the surface. The superhydrophobic surface is just only visible via this small line caused by the reflection of light at the interface between our superhydrophobic surface towards air. This shows an image of the droplet just resting on the particle just underneath. And what I like to stress, despite the fact that our particles were hydrophilic, still we observed an air cushion underneath. So the droplet still rests on some kind of an air cushion, despite the fact that we have hydrophilic particles. And the reason is because also on a hydrophilic particle, the water likes to take a preferred contact angle, which is in this case close to 50 degrees. And therefore, it takes an energy barrier or takes energy to fully wet the particle. This last photo or image shows the situation at the backside of the droplet. And now I like to stress two aspects. On the one hand, beyond the droplet, you do not see any particles. So all particles are picked up. Furthermore, you see that here at the water meniscus, we have a large number of particles. And the reason is that the particles sediment while moving, while the droplet moves, because the particles are heavy. So now, knowing how the situation looks like at the backside of the drop, we can estimate the force which needs to be overcome, that a particle is picked up by the droplet. And this force is just given by the competition between the capillary force and the adhesion force. The capillary force needs to be at least as large or larger than the adhesion force. If that is the situation, then the particle is picked up. The capillary force is again given by Hooke's law and depends on the spring constant of the water meniscus multiplied by the deflection of the water meniscus. However, this deflection is very small, and therefore the next step I like to express is by the adhesion force, which can be measured more easily. The adhesion force is the force given or depends on the size of the particle. So the larger the particle, the larger the adhesion, on the effective roughness, and the difference in the interfacial energies. So the interfacial energy, if the particle makes contact towards air and we have solid air contact, minus the interfacial energy if we have particle substrate contact. How now to get the friction force? And that is what we wanted. Therefore, just let's go from the adhesion to the work. The droplet needs to overcome to move or to move forward by a certain distance delta x. And this work to move a droplet depends on the apparent contact area, the width of the apparent contact area, the number of particles along this, the width of the apparent contact area, the work to pick up a single particle times the distance the droplet is moving. And then just going from Hooke's law, we get the work, or we can calculate the work to pick up a single particle. And here we replace the capillary force by the adhesion force, because while a particle is picked up, they need to be at least equal. Now from that we get the friction force, that is the work to move the droplet by a certain distance divided by the distance, and we obtain that the friction for scales with the width of the apparent contact area, the effective roughness, and the interfacial energy which needs to be overcome to lift off the particle, and the spring constant of the water meniscus. Now, if we insert values, we end up with a friction force in the order of 3, just let's say a few micronewton. And this friction force does not depend on the particle size, which is at first in glance sounds to be surprising, because we know that if we have larger particles, then we also have a larger adhesion. So therefore, how is this possible? That the friction does not depend on the particle size, and therefore we need to keep in to mind, if we have larger particles, we also have less particles along the contact line. And therefore the particle radius just cancels out. So now measuring the friction force to see whether this makes sense, what we estimated. This can be done again using our capillary. And from the deflection of the capillary, we directly get the friction force. And indeed, here for you see the measurements for hydrophilic particles of different particle size. And indeed, the friction force is in the order of a few micronewton and does not depend on particle size to first order. The picture completely changes as soon as we have a fully contaminated droplet. So then we do not have any longer that the particles move or that the droplet moves over particles, but now we have liquid marble implying that particles move over particles. So from that, I like to summarize. I hope I have shown you that the friction force can be calculated from the deflection of a cantilever, that the force depends on the contact angles and the contact width. If we go for the adhesion description, and that both forces are identical, and therefore we can just go for using the capillary, which is in general much easier to get the friction. So the friction, the droplet experience while moving over a particle, and this friction can also be used, or the setup can also be used to estimate the force the droplet needs to remove particles. And what is important, that particles are picked up at the backside, and they are picked up as soon as the capillary force overcomes the adhesion force. With that, I like to thank the people who greatly contributed to this work, in particular Nand Gao and Florian Geier, and Maria da Kunzi, Rüdiger Berger, Hans-Jürgen Butt, Frank Schellenberger, Lena Mamm, and Maxim Paven. And I like to thank you for your attention.